Hello and welcome. In this video, I will show you how socioeconomic factors affect natural resource use. In this picture, you see the water consumption pattern of 42 Dutch households. Within this household, each person uses about 120 liters of drinking water per day. You can clearly see various peaks in the morning and in the evening. In a more abstract form, this is the water consumption patterns in some other parts of the world. Only a bare minimum of water, a bucketful, is available for some cooking, drinking, and personal hygiene. If service infrastructures make access to water and any other resource easier, then generally consumption of that resource goes up. Paired with the change in our perception about hygiene, this leads to a higher overall consumption, as for instance shown in this graph of water consumption since the 1970s in the Netherlands. What can also be observed is that with higher income, you're more likely to have access to services and to use more resources. In this picture of the UN, you can see the relationship between income and access to water. You can see that only 5% of the poorest in sub-Saharan Africa have access to piped water at home, while 62% of the richest have. You can further see that improved access and unimproved access dominates the more poor or second and middle income classes. Improved access includes standposts such as this one. This implies that getting water is laborious and time consuming, therefore most probably reducing water consumption. Getting water is, by the way, mostly done by women. Looking in more general terms at resource use and socioeconomic indicators such as GDP or income, a positive relationship between the two can be observed. In this graph, it can be seen how the global gross domestic product has grown and material input has increased alongside it while at a slower pace. The strongest increase can be observed for construction minerals, which grew by a factor of 32, which is actually due to the development of cities and population growth. Ores and industrial minerals are used grow by a factor of 27, and fossil energy carriers by a factor of 12. Biomass extraction increased only 3.6-fold because earlier much more biomass for power production was used, which is now replaced by fossil fuels. That this trend holds is also confirmed by another study that compared the metabolic rates of countries with its GDP, shown here in the diagonal line. But some other things can be observed too from this graph. There are a number of outliers. This suggests that it is possible for some countries to achieve relatively high incomes per capita while consuming fewer resources per capita. Down here. On the other hand, it also shows that other countries display very high resource consumption levels per capita without corresponding rises in income per capita. This is related to many factors, like population density, but it also strongly related to the type of economy and trade. For example, countries that rely on lignite or brown coal instead of gas as an energy source will show higher metabolic rates. This is because the metabolic rate is measured in weight, and as lignite contains less energy per metric ton than gas, the metabolic rate is higher. Countries may also shift their domestic economy towards services, reducing their primary and secondary sector and increasing their dependency on imported manufactured goods. This leads to a lowering of domestic resource use, while income per capita rises, and it also leads to a shift of the material and environmental burden to developing countries. Finally, there is evidence that the population density has a positive influence on the resource consumption. Therefore, also giving cities or mainly urbanized countries a lower resource consumption. Yet, there is even a fourth factor which is proposed to affect resource use. That is the fact that with increasing wealth of a society, the resource use and the environmental impact actually reduces. This is the so-called decoupling of economic growth from natural resource use and environmental impact. This simply means that more economic output can be produced with less resources, so-called resource decoupling, and that environmental impact reduces while economic output increases, so-called impact decoupling. Taking the initial example of water use in the Netherlands, this trend can actually be observed, as you can see in the recent slight decline of water use per capita. The reason for this decline may be related to new environmental consciousness, more innovation in terms of household appliances, and infrastructure. In general, this relationship has been proposed as the environmental Kuznet curve, named after the economist Simon Kuznet. As can be seen here, it shows that with increasing wealth, there will be a turning point in natural resource use and environmental impact. While this curve seems to hold true for some resources, such as water, this relationship is not evident for other resources, such as the decline of fisheries, for instance. Though this is still subject to some debate in the scientific community. But the question remains, how can decoupling then be achieved? The UN Environmental Programme report on decoupling natural resource use and environmental impact from economic growth put cities forward as places for reaching this decoupling. They have two key arguments for this. Firstly, the positive relationship between density and resource use. And secondly, the fact that cities are hubs of innovation. In the report, they argue that system innovation is necessary rather than optimization. By this, they mean that what is required are innovations across many different aspects: technical, in the rules and regulations that we have, in the values and norms you have, so for instance, if you value the environment, and the daily practices of each of us, so for example, how you shower. They also highlight that developing countries should not follow the route of economic growth and resource consumption developed countries have in the past, but rather that developing countries, and especially the fast-growing cities within them, should directly pursue the decoupling pathway of growth. So, do the better off in your city use more resources, or do they invest the money into sustainable practices?